January 21st, 1953 was a great day. It was the day of my nativity, which means that in 3 months it will be the 67th anniversary of that nativity. Now, I don't recall the scene, but I understand what it would have looked like, because I've talked to nurses and doctors from that era who have explained to me how it really went down. It happened in Peterborough Civic Hospital, which was a newly opened facility, just opened about 2.5 years previously. And my mother and I were separated from my father at that day. He sat in the waiting room along with other fathers. And I know there were other fathers because I've met some of the kids that were born that day. And they sat together in this waiting room, some of them most likely smoking to calm the nerves, waiting for the nurse to come and tell them the news of the arrival of either a boy or a girl, which would have been the first time that news would have been known. Dad would have been allowed to go down the hallway to the nursery and to view me from behind the window as a nurse brought my bassinet closer and he could see what he had helped to make and was stuck with. And then meanwhile, Mom was returned to her room and with other mums. And at the right time, I would be brought in for feeding and holding and then returned to my spare room. And this would continue for 5 days until Mom and I were deemed ready to go home and start life. My, how things have changed in 66 years. Today, in hospitals, babies are being born with dad and grandma and grandpa and aunts and uncles and other children and then maybe even the janitor sometimes, all in on this event of this child being brought into the world. Mom is immediately given the child and dad is given a chance to cut the cord. And then later that day, mom and baby are sent home to start life. Of course, babies are not all born in the hospital now today. Now we have midwives and home birthing agencies everywhere to encourage childbirth and to bring childbirth back into the place that it was when my mother was born in home. And dads share prenatal class and learn their role in birth. And the mystery of childbirth was ripped out of the labor and delivery room and explained to shocked males. I begin with birth because it is one of two events in life that every human being will participate in. The other, of course, is death and our exit out of this life. And why do I share that? Well, I share it because what took place regarding childbirth, which entailed a total cultural shift, a new way of understanding, a new way of participating in birth, needs to take place in death. And it is starting. We are making some strides. But like childbirth, the culture of death needs to be changed to allow for a much more inclusive, participatory, and meaningful part of life that will also result in the mystery of death being ripped out of the medical world and opened up to all of us again. And the culture is changing. That's a testament to the fact that Providence is willing to have this topic as a theme for your lecture series this year. Thank you. I doubt this probably could have happened a few years ago because culture, we weren't wanting or ready to discuss this topic openly. And you're here, and I appreciated those that came last night and that those of you, just even the students that have to be here, are here today. And I hope that it's a beginning of discussion. I hope it's the beginning of the conversation. And I hope that as we engage in this topic, that it will be encouraging to you to pursue this and to continue the conversation. Well, what exactly, if we have to shift this culture, if we have to change things, what exactly is the problem in the way things are that has created this challenge around death and dying for us? Well, first of all, we struggle with knowing what death actually is. Manitoba is the only province in Canada that has a legal definition of death. And in Manitoba, the legal definition of death is that death is at the time at which irreversible cessation of all that person's brain functions occur. No other province in Canada has a legal definition of death. And unlike what we will talk about this afternoon with medical-assisted dying, decisions around death in this case are being driven by medicine and religion, and the courts are forced to catch up and deal with the legalities of death and dying. In particular, there were two court cases towards the end of 2017, both of them in the GTA, the Greater Toronto Area, and both of these cases challenged the doctor's declarations of death. In fact, the death certificates had been signed, and the families sought an injunction that challenged both physicians' declaration of death. And they won an injunction that kept these people on life support. The first woman was Tagush McKitty. She was a 27-year-old Christian woman who was declared brain dead. But after the court injunction, she stayed on life support for another 15 months until her heart stopped. Shalom Otama was a 25-year-old Jewish man who had suffered a severe asthmatic attack, and he remained on life support system for 6 months after the doctors had declared him dead, brain dead, and it took 6 months before his heart stopped. And herein lies the difficulty. In both cases, death was being defined by two different criteria. Death was being defined in one way by religious teachings. And in both of these religious cases, it was the heart that determined death, not the absence of brain activity, which is the medical standard. In the end, the appeals courts never did offer a final ruling because the people had died before the case was concluded. But it's going to continue to be an issue in Canada. McKitty's father stated, quote, "If a person can't rely on their most sacred religious values and beliefs at the moment of death, when they would expect to derive comfort from them, one is left to wonder the value of constitutional protection of religious liberty and equality." And so at present, the whole question of what is death is open to challenge, other than in Manitoba. But it will continue. But we're also a culture of avoidance. We've stopped talking about death. We don't use the D word. Last night, we came up with a total of, as we counted them up, probably 20, 25 euphemisms that people use instead of saying the word die or died. We talk about people passing or passed away or passed on, or people who are seriously ill as they're approaching their own dying. And families, because we avoid that, families don't know that death is approaching. And when they are faced with that, all of a sudden they have to figure it out. I have been in a room at hospice where the person is on the bed is literally within probably 48 hours of death. And the family is there, and I've said to the family, you know he's dying. Oh no, he's not dying yet. We're not ready yet. He's not really dying. He'll always get over this. And because we're afraid of facing that and talking about it, when death actually starts to show up, suddenly there's this panic. Now, it's a real problem. I watch families sit around the bedside of dying loved one, not knowing what to say to each other, and certainly not knowing what to say to the dying person. But the dying person doesn't know what to say either, and doesn't know what to expect as death comes closer. I get these panic phone calls from people coming to asking me to come and start the conversation because we don't know what to say or how to get started talking about somebody's dying. And so I see the anxiety and the fear and the despair fill a room where people talk about everything else except the fact that somebody is dying. And so if we can deal with the elephant in the room, suddenly we make space for things that need to be shared and talked about. And it's amazing what fills that space. Expressions of love, and joy, and laughter, and sadness, and shared pain, and forgiveness, and gratitude, and memories, and touch. All those things that were paralyzed because we didn't know what to say or how to start. We have lost the rich wisdom of human dying. We do not know what to expect in the process. And the challenge of not talking about it robs us of knowing what to say or do as death approaches. We are also a culture that holds on to things that were never meant to be held on to forever. Death only sneaks up on us because we haven't noticed the clues, the very clues that she has hidden in plain sight. And that is because we don't see our own dying as part of our own living. George Harrison sang, "All things must pass. Sunrise doesn't last all morning, and a cloudburst doesn't last all day. All things must pass." Impermanence. Impermanence is the gift of becoming. And we fight impermanence by trying everything to control life and bring security into existence. But at death, the body shuts down. The body does what it's supposed to do. And the truth of that, the truth of life, is that change and impermanence and death are a constant for every one of us. When we live this way, when we live as though we're holding on to things forever and they will never change, it strengthens ignorance. It sets up habits of cravings and of defense and regret. And those are the very obstacles to having death at the very end be something in which we call, and for lack of a better term, a good death. And that lesson is humbling. Death is absolutely certain, and yet the way it will be manifested is completely unpredictable. Now, we can either shrink in fear, or we can choose a different response. Unfortunately, we are taught that death and dying are extraordinary, rather than that they are part of our living. Montaigne said, "Let us deprive death of its strangeness. Let us frequent it. Let us get used to it. Think often of death and get on with life. I want death to find me planting my cabbages, neither worrying about it or about an unfinished garden." I had a woman just recently, 2 weeks ago, who was recently diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer, had metastasized. And she's in her early 50s. And she's a woman who her whole life has really paid a lot of attention to her appearance. She dresses beautifully. She's always careful about how she appears in public. But she was, when we got talking about some of the changes that were happening as this diagnosis had come into her life, one of the biggest challenges, she said to me, is, "I can't go shopping anymore." I said, "Why not? Why can't you go shopping?" "Well, there's no use me buying these clothes. I'm not going to get to wear them." And I said, "Well, why wouldn't you buy them anyway? Do you enjoy shopping? Is it part of life? Is it something that you engage in?" And to be able to see how just because we're going to die doesn't stop us from living. Now, I said, you might not want to go out and buy that sports car right yet, and make sure you got the money in the bank. But impermanence actually helps us to live better if we can put things into place. I'm going to read a couple of readings that I've done over the over my time, because writing is some of the things that I do. But I did write about impermanence. I can find it. But it's one of those things that that challenges our ability to live and to live well. All right, it's here. The struggle to hold on. Impermanence, everything changes. It's amazing how this simple truth gets so much resistance, even when we know it's true. The difficulty comes at times in life when what is changing is perceived to be a threat to our stability, our enjoyment, our comfort, or our future. The shocking news of a life-threatening illness is one of those times when we struggle against change the most, and perhaps rightly so. After all, the changes that we see involve the control of our health, our time, and our very life. It's no wonder that the language used to describe life at this point is the language of war and struggle. And yet, in the struggle to hold on to what we cannot hold on to, we create a web of suffering that becomes the very air we breathe. The brave fight against disease is often acknowledged at death and held up as a valiant fight, even although it was not winnable. How do we embrace the reality of impermanence without simply giving up and shutting down life? If we can embrace impermanence well, while we experience the losses of what we cannot hold on to, we will have the opportunity to experience the new gifts that are being offered to us. So how do we embrace change and loss without a stance of giving up and giving in? And I believe it begins with facing and acknowledging in an honoring way the changes that are happening. Perhaps this begins with a grateful realization that your body has done you well for many years, that the changes happening do not negate our gratitude for the years that it has served us well and fought for us against infection and injury and aging. It's not that the physical body is simply giving up, but rather it's following its own path of impermanence. And impermanence will allow the body to continue to do what it can do best, even in the reality of a disease. Impermanence means that instead of going out and shoveling the dirt in the yard, we go down and lay down and have a nap. Our gratitude to our body for showing us our journey is often set aside in feelings of failure or fear that we are not able to do what we used to do. What if it's possible to allow your body to help us with the reality of change as healthy, not as failure? Secondly, I believe we can do this by holding on to things lightly rather than tightly. We have become a society that finds our meaning and value and worth in what we do or what we have or what other people say about us. This demands that we hold on to things and doing and reputation in ways that do not allow for impermanence. Instead, we hand over control of ourselves to these things which were never meant to be the same. Illness and dying immediately confront the strongholds we have built, and when they cannot withstand what is happening, we are left with feelings of meaninglessness and valuelessness without a sense of who we are. What if we held on to those things like doing and having and perception and presence more loosely? What would it look like if we found meaning and value and presence in more than these things, so that when change comes, these areas are not void of meaning in life? Finally, it's important to be fully in the moment of life that we are in without constantly need to measure value and worth by what we used to do and the haunting fear of what we won't be able to do in the future. It is the ability to embrace where we find ourselves now and to put all of our effort into being thankful and active in ways that are possible now. Today, I can find the strength to go and sit in the garden and observe and wonder. It's not the feeling of failure that I can't dig in the garden like I did last year, or the anxiety of whether I'll be able to get in the garden next month. It's the action and gratitude and wonder of being in the garden today and finding my soul touched by the wonders of this moment. What possible gifts can come our way if we can embrace impermanence well? I've watched people find wonder in the simple activity of watching a child eat a sandwich with great enjoyment. I've listened to people describe vivid detail the time they watched a hummingbird feed, a feeder that had been there year after year, and yet for the first time, they took the time to observe. It's the gift of loving people in the moment for who they are, the expressing of that love spontaneously without having to filter it through the lens of how we used to do it. It's the gift of mystery, not certainty, of not needing to know or not needing to be right. Each day is a reminder of impermanence. Nature is its ambassador, and disease is the unknown guide to open a world to the way it has always been. Impermanence. Sally Tisdale, in her book, Advice for Future Corpses, great book to carry on the bus, said that contemplating death is really contemplating resistance, and for a long time. How do we get ready to die? Well, we start with not being ready, and we start with the fact that we are afraid, and it takes a long examination of that fear, and we start by admitting that we are all future corpses, pretending that we don't know. Let's just, how did we get here? Michael Curl, who's a sociologist, says that death is a socially constructed idea. The fears, hopes, orientations that people have toward it are not instinctive, but rather are learned from such public symbols as the languages, arts, religion, and funerary rituals of the culture. Every culture and subculture has a coherent mortality thesis, whose explanations of death are so thoroughly ingrained that they are believed to be right by its members. Not everybody who dies in hospice is old. We have very young people die in hospice. We have one pediatric room at hospice. But we have lots of children in visiting, grandma, grandpa, children of mom and dad, kids. Kids are not afraid of death. Kids are not afraid of dying. They have lots of questions, believe me. But it's not an instinctive piece that is there. It is a learned piece that is there. I say to parents when they struggle with what should I tell my children, I begin with, what are you afraid of telling your children? That the real challenge of knowledge and understanding of death and life isn't, the problem isn't with the child, the problem is with our own fears around what that is. So death is this, our understanding of death, your understanding of death, your fears of death, your avoidance of death is not an instinctive piece of humanity. It's what we've learned. And we've learned it from many different places. We've learned it from the languages and the arts. We've learned it from funerary practices. Many have learned it from their religion, actually. And we'll talk about that in a moment. So one of the ways in which we have to be honest, if we're going to look at death and dying, is to perhaps begin by as much as possible at least acknowledging those pieces of our life that have shaped our attitudes toward death and dying, and then maybe perhaps how we might change that. For instance, death may be considered either as the end of existence or a transition into a state of being or consciousness. For example, Buddhists and Hindus, for those groups, the arch ordeal envisioned is not death. It's not about the end of death, but rather it's the end of the pain of having to undergo another rebirth. And the goal for a Buddhist is the end of rebirth, not the end of death, which is the goal of Christianity. Death is seen as the end of our existence here, and a transitionary, perhaps. But how do we view death? How do we look upon death? What does death mean to you? I'm going to show a couple of videos, one of them very shortly. I have two clients that I've who've given me permission to talk to you. They know that that's what they were doing. One of them this morning, one of them this afternoon, who has chosen a trajectory of MAID. But this morning, in both cases, I asked them that question: what does death mean to you? What does death mean to you? How do we understand death as what it means about it? If it is that which becomes an event of total fear, then what is that about? Where does that begin? Very quickly, because I've got to get to the video, I know that. So whereas death is a fact, something that happens to you, dying is primarily an activity. One of the interesting questions I ask people is, are you dying now? Do you think you're dying now? When do we start to die? When does that designation, have you ever heard that talked about people, oh, that person, oh, they're dying. Or I heard that person is dying. When do we give them that designation? Are you dying? Am I dying? Well, intellectually, we all say that, of course we are. But we don't believe that. We have labels that we put on people, such as dying. But when does that occur? When do we start to actually identify somebody at that particular point? Dying is something we do. We're not born with our attitudes towards death and dying. We are socialized into those by our culture. Now, I don't have time to go over Michael Carroll, who talks about, who writes a book, and he that was his quote there. But Philippe Ares, who was a French medieval historian, looks at attitudes of death, and he has looked through history, and he finds different eras in our history where death was understood differently. Back in the 17th century, he talked about a tame death. That's where people expected their own death. They prepared for their own dying. It wasn't something to be feared. They actually made very elaborate preparations for their own dying. There was then in the 12th century, 11th, 12th century, a shift to where there was more of a recognition of this is my death, and it was much more of a personalization of death. Death became a little more personal. In the 18th century, we had this death of the other, and in both of these cases, Christianity played a large part of shaping attitudes around death and dying. It was in this later part of our own death and thy death where we personalized death, where tombs started to come up with individual names and descriptions about the person. It's quite a fascinating history. But what I want to focus on is this later one, the 19th and 20th century, which he calls a forbidden death or a denied death. And we've talked about a denial of death. This is a death-denying culture. I actually believe the new generation, your students, I don't think live in death denial. I think they live in death defying. And that we observe this shift in activity and approaching a life in a way where death is very much a possibility of activity, but it's engaged in. So we have this death denying, almost this death defying approach to death in our culture. So, and I'm not going to have a time to do this, but what I want to get to is that there are certain factors that we all utilize that shape our attitudes of death. One of the ones that has shaped our attitudes perhaps the most is around the medical shift. So the last 75 to 100 years, our culture has undergone a very dramatic shift as the result of medical advances that have played, in my opinion, one of the most important pieces towards our understanding and attitude toward death and dying. Let me try to explain it to you. In my work, I'm often asked to see a person and their family right after they have had a new diagnosis of a life-threatening illness. And what I encounter is this medical model that we as a society have engaged in for the past 75 to 100 years. And it goes like this. All illnesses of the body and the mind have, if one can look hard enough, an underlying cause. And if we can find that cause, which is the diagnosis, that's the word, then we find a way to remove or reverse or to replace or to bypass that. That's called treatment. And if we can diagnose and treat, then we can return to the status quo, which is called the cure. And the medical model that we have engaged in is a model that says we need to find out and name what is wrong with you, and then we'll find the treatment to deal with that that will cure the problem. And as that truth goes, as models go, on some levels, that model, medical model has worked well. It has led to many cures being found for an increasing number of illnesses. The plethora of new drugs and treatments that are available have not only extended the quantity of life, but in many cases extended the quantity of life, but in many cases have also improved the quantity and the quality of life for countless of sick individuals. But where the medical model runs into trouble is when it is confronted by an insolvable problem. Now, in Western healthcare, this happens to be when an illness is diagnosed as terminal. Terminal. And however that moment inevitably arrives for all of us, we're all terminal. But no matter how it occurs and the unique way that we have of dealing with that, there comes a moment when we discover that we are mortally wounded, that there is no treatment and cure. And in my experience, when that point is reached, the reactions to that are mirrored both by the patients and by healthcare professionals, believe it or not. Because this is what happens. This is my experience. When the initial shock wears off, there's this unrelenting search for a remedy, and a struggle to get out of the prison of suffering begins. And the attitude that immediately becomes the focal point, and I hear it all the time, is, you know, we're going to beat this. We've had a lot of trouble in the past. We've gone through everything. We're going to find a way to get through this too. And that's referred to as the heroic stance. That's what you see in the obituaries when they say they fought a courageous battle with cancer. It's this idea that somehow I can find it. We can find it if we only look hard enough. And that leads to the fact that it's just a matter of trying and trying harder. And if we can do that and look further and further afield, we'll find that cure. And literally thousands and hundreds of thousands of dollars have been spent by some clients looking for that miracle cure. And social media has opened to the world of possibilities. True story from my own files. People have included things like mistletoe, turmeric, dog food, even urine, as that elusive cure for cancer. However, this kind of response is only a seed for emotional pain that is characterized by frustration and powerlessness and a growing fear of what the future might bring. Dying is not just a medical event. It's as much an emotional and spiritual journey as well. And those feelings of powerlessness and frustration as they watch the disease progress are compounded by the hurt and the fear and the disbelief that they can't find that cure, despite all of one's courage. So what do we need? Well, we need, as I said before, like we saw with birth, a shift in the culture and approach to birth. We need a shift in the way in which we approach our own dying. There are three questions, and I'm going to skip that. The three questions that I ask people when they, often, you know, they say to me, how do you start the conversation? How do we change the attitudes of death? Here are the three questions that I often ask people. What do you think happens at death? What do you think that moment's like? I've been with so many people at death, that moment where suddenly they're here and then they're not. It's the most sacred moment and stillness that I've ever experienced. But what do you think that's like for the person dying? I don't know, because I've never done it. And I say to people, you're the expert, you're doing it. What do you think it's going to be like for you? That moment of death. Second question, the reason I ask that is I want to know what fears you have. I want to know what you're expecting. I want to know what we need to work with there. The second question is, what do you think happens after death? I'm not there to tell them what I believe. I need to know what it is they're expecting. What does death mean to you? What do you think happens after? But it's this third one that is really the key. How do I prepare for my own dying? What do you need to do? How do you need to do that? Over the years, I have sat with literally thousands of people in grief. Grief that has come as a result of sudden death, accident, suicide, homicide, grief caused by illness and disease, or simply running out of life. And they've been shared by shattered parents and children and spouses and teams and families, some of them estranged, some of them close. In the end, here it is. There's no harder or easier category with death and dying. It's just simply different, and that we all die. How do we wrap up life? I'm going to show you a video, but before I do, I just one more reading here that I want to share with you that talks about some of the things that maybe we need to pay attention to. This is one of my clients. Her name has changed. We sat in her living room. She reclined in her chair, me comfortably settled into the love seat. The only other creature settling in was the dog, who by all appearances was as palliative as her master. It was a warm July day, and the humidity that hung in the air was a real challenge to Cora's breathing. Her once vibrant physical body was now skeletal, although her recent bout with fluid-retaining medications had left her swollen and puffy. Cora is a wonderful client. She's one of those that when I see her name on the list for that day, I smile. From the very first time we met, I knew that this journey of her living toward her dying was going to be one that she would share freely and openly. On her wall in the living room, which also now housed the hospital bed and served as her bedroom as well, were pictures of her children, three of them. Her pride and joy, her daughter would be coming on the weekend, and she so looked forward to that. Her son had been there recently, and he was in contact with her every day. And she told me with pride about her oldest son. He was killed in an accident when he was 32, half a lifetime ago, but he was as much a part of her life now as always. Today, the discussion was about what's next. Cora's struggle to breathe and to find some relief from pain was a constant second-by-second struggle. Her doctor had been fabulous in his loving care and attention to managing the disease that allowed Cora to engage with her vast circle of friends and her children, but time is running out. As we sat there, she told me with halting breath about how she had cared for every detail of the things required before she died. She told me how she had handwritten personal notes in specially chosen cards to each of her many, many friends. She stopped and paused, and then she said, "Well, I guess I'm wrapping up my life." What's it like to wrap up one's life? Many people don't get a chance to do that. Life ends abruptly, unexpectedly, and without forewarning to pay attention to what we might wish we could pay attention to. For clients of hospice, there is this gift of being able to wrap up life, although it's never seen that way at first. What would it mean to you to wrap up your life? What things would you put on that list? Things to tidy up, people to see, details to pay attention to that don't have priority when time is squeezed. It's not a bucket list, things that you've always wanted to do but didn't get a chance to. That's different. This is about paying attention to the things of your life that still need some detail in wrapping up. I think of the people in my life that I've connected with. There are those who come into your life for a bit and then leave. Sometimes that leaving's good, and sometimes it's left at loose ends. Who would I choose to say, you know, in wrapping up my life, there's something I need to say? What detail around things and stuff needs to be wrapped up? I don't know if it's possible to fully wrap up one's life when one isn't faced with the evidence that we need to be doing this, but I have come to the conclusion that some of this may be helpful to pay attention to now. I think that one can only wrap up what one has started. We wrap up relationships that are still ongoing by paying attention to things in those relationships that need to be attended to. When I left that day, I had no idea if this was the last time that we would laugh and cry together. I turned at the door and I looked at her and I said, "Well, I guess this is a wrap." And she grinned and gave me two thumbs up. And she died later that week. Okay, so again, thanks, Amy. And just kind of help us understand a little bit about your diagnosis and what brought you to this point.
Okay, so it all started about close to 20 years ago now, 19 this year. I had just turned 30 and I was having lots of neurological things start to happen in my body that they weren't sure what was going on. Lots of numbness, tingling, nauseous, all kinds of things. And I'd been to the doctor several times, to emerge several times. Nobody was really getting to the bottom of things until they finally sent me to a neurologist who then sent me for an MRI. And he diagnosed me at that point with multiple sclerosis. Yeah, so that was 19 years ago now.
Wow. Mm-hmm. It's been a real journey then for 19 years.
It's been a real
years.
Journey, yeah. That changed, you know, there's always that moment of before diagnosis and after.
Right, right.
It's, yeah, that's kind of how you look at your life then, you know.
When did you first kind of have this realization that probably you were going to die sooner than maybe what you had planned on?
Right. Yeah, that's a great question. I had to think about that, you know. I think when I got diagnosed, there was a moment in myself that even though everything around me, it was like, they had just come out with a new drug for me to try, and there was so much positive information coming out about MS at the time, because before that there was really nothing you could do. You were sent home, good luck, everybody fares differently, so it was really hard to wrap your mind around where you were going to land on that spectrum, right?
Right.
So, but I think inside there was something that happened to me, an inner dialogue that was like, what does this mean? How long, you know, and how much do I, not only how long will I survive this, you know, disease, or how long will it take me to, but also the questions about like how painful that process will be. So I definitely, there was an awareness that, wow, okay, I'm going to be carrying this now for however long. And it may be the thing that takes me out, but I could go from something else too. So you had to kind of learn how to kind of hold both at the same time and also be positive for everyone else around you and all these things, you know, that you are also feeling like, okay, now, like, this is probably going to change things, not just for me, but for everyone else that I love close to me too. Yeah. So
what was that like for you to hear that diagnosis? And
the first one or the second one? The first one was devastating because I just wasn't prepared for it. We went to see the neurologist to get the results, and he was I don't think he, for a neurologist who makes these diagnoses, I just don't think he has a clue the impact the statement he was going to make had on me. Because when we walked into his room, we sat down, he looked up, he said our names, and then he began to look for a file. And then when he opened the file, he began to flip through it like he'd never seen it before. And then he said, oh, okay, yes, lesions, you have multiple sclerosis. Shut the folder and pushed it. And we're like, are you kidding me? That's it? That's how you tell us? And then he asked me what I did for a living. I told him I was self-employed, and he said, time to get a new job because the medications, you have a choice of three. The cheapest one is $17,000 a year. And I was like, I was still dealing with that first statement he made that my wife has multiple sclerosis and couldn't even process this whole idea that the drug, the cheapest drug that she could go on is $17,000. And I was just devastated. And we went out to the car and sat in the car, and I remember I just wept, and Amy was pretty okay. She wasn't okay. She was dealing with it better than me because for her, the disease now had a name. For me, there was a disease. And I wasn't feeling what she was feeling in her body. She'd been told by many doctors she was just crazy. It was mental health, all those things. So for her to have a diagnosis, it was kind of a bittersweet. It felt good, but for me, I just couldn't handle that. So that was devastating. That was 20 years ago. And then when it came back aggressively 5 years ago, once again, it was still an ambiguous diagnosis because of how severe the attack was. Like in 14 days, healthy to paralyzed. Even that every doctor said, yeah, I've never seen anything like it. And so I think there was a lot of ambiguity for me that went along. I was not practicing non-resistance. I was definitely in denial for months because I just didn't, I couldn't fathom. If the doctors don't know what it is, then, you know, maybe it's not as bad as it seems. Maybe it's an anomaly or whatever. So, yeah, I had hoped I'd learned a lot 20 years ago that would have helped me 5 years ago. But the problem was I wasn't the same man that I was 20 years ago. Some ways I'd learned a lot, but in some ways, still living my life in denial of experiences I didn't want to experience. So, yeah, it was devastating both times.
Was that where did death come into that? I mean, was it the disease or the fear of Amy dying that really?
So for me, I actually remember the exact moment when I kind of gave up denying that this was a chronic illness, that this was kind of a debilitating disease that would get worse. I remember I made a list of all the different things I wanted our doctor to test Amy for. There were 14 different things over the course of years I wanted him to test her for. Guillain-Barré syndrome, Lyme disease, you name it, because I was constantly searching for a cure. And I remember the day, maybe 3 years ago, we were in the neurologist's office at Sunnybrook Hospital, and he pulled out the MRI scan for us to look at and showed us the area of injury on her spinal cord and all the muscles that had atrophied around it. And that's the first time we were ever given anything concrete to look at, right? So the doctor tells you this is what's going on, but we've never seen it. We don't see pictures. You know, I haven't. And so looking at this MRI scan, seeing what the disease has done, it just, I couldn't deny it anymore. And so that moment, I remember just something clicked in me, and it was like, I'm not going to resist this word anymore. I'm not going to resist this notion that this is a serious chronic illness that will, you know, head in a certain direction. And it felt strangely satisfying, because denial is a terrible thing. You're skeptical of everything, and you're never settled, right? You're always looking for something. So that was about 3 years ago, and it set me on a trajectory of this living a non-resistant life instead of just resisting bad things, because I'm actually accepting things as they are, and then from that place of acceptance, rising up and responding accordingly. That's a way better way to deal with any news you get. And so it made me a better care provider, knowing that, yeah, this is not going to get better. And so if I take that to its trajectory, that is death. That's exactly what it is. And the more you think about that kind of thing, the less fear you have about it. So that was probably, like I said, I remember the exact moment that shift happened in my thinking. And it wasn't my choice, but it was liberating when it happened.
Yeah. Wow. So have you thought about death much, Amy?
Yes, I have, actually. I do. I do go there in my mind. I write a lot when I go through things, and I've written down a lot. Whenever I am in the middle of a big attack, I usually, you know, write even more about what I actually want, what I want it to feel like, look like, sound like, you know, and it's not a negative thing to me anymore. It's not a, it doesn't, like Aaron said, there's so much less fear around what's actually, you know, it's more, for me, if there's anything that I feel uncomfortable about, it's the pain level, which I think is really human and natural and important to really face too, because the people around you, as they're preparing or as they get ready or have to go through it, that part of it is so personal when it comes to the person going, right?
Yeah.
So, lily plants around his bed, because he wants to, if he does go, whenever it happens, to be surrounded by beauty. And I thought, wow, that is such an incredible visual, you know, and it really resonated with me, you know, because when I think about it, I just think, you know, whenever I'm in the middle of an attack, I just think, I go to that place in my mind where, you know, I'm in bed and I'm just surrounded by the people that I love, you know. At the end of the day, I think that's what you have. That's what you should hope for anyways, is that you are surrounded by the love and tenderness that has carried you all the way to that point. And that's what I want, you know, above all, is to be surrounded by, there'll probably be some good music playing, and if I have anything to do with it, good. And a lot of beauty around me too, but just, yeah, my loved ones, that's what it all comes down to. At the end of the day, all of the other stuff, yeah, I think, you know, I have, you know, there's places in my mind where once in a while, if I'm really, really sick or feeling down, I've had, you know, that loop play over, you know, well, what is the transition time, or how do people make decisions about, you know, end of life, you know, like when you have this kind of a disease and if it gets really painful or really bad, you know, I do have those kind of conversations with myself, but haven't really landed anywhere concrete, but I'm definitely open to everything. And I think that's important too, with the kind of thing that we are dealing with, for me anyways.
Now, you've had some experiences with death throughout your life.
Yes.
What did they teach you, or how did they help shape your understanding of that a little bit?
Well, the biggest and most profound loss that I have had up until this point, I would say, would be the loss of my mother. She died in a car accident. And, but the profound mark that she left, was not the way that she left, but the way that she, faced and talked about death herself. To me, she was really open about her own death and was really comfortable and, talking to me about her wishes and about, you know, just really made it, approachable for me. And I was actually really uncomfortable when she first would start, you know, I'm like, I don't want to talk, you know, she'd be like, you know, there's my plot over there. And that what, you know, she was just so laid back about it. And I just, and I think it's because she had dealt with, you know, she survived polio as a child. She had cancer as an adult, you know, she had all these things that could have taken her out. And so I think she just realized that when your time is your time, you know, just, and yeah, and then she ended up dying in a car accident. So I was so grateful for all the conversations and all the openness because it was a real gift to me at that time. And I realized it. I didn't realize it till then, you know, what, because she was not sick when she died. So it's not even like everyone get, you know everyone doesn't get that, right? We're all going. But, and we, nobody knows when that bus actually is going to pull up necessarily. And right. You know, so yeah, I would say that was really profound. Also, my mother-in-law, 2 years after that died of literally, 12 weeks from diagnosis to dying of cancer of the stomach. So that taught me a lot too about, like I really valued the conversations I had with her at the end, the intimacy of those, you know, conversations that I got to have with her and was really grateful for that with her. But definitely, yeah, so I would say losing our mothers would have been the most profound and, yeah, life-teaching things, I guess, about death before my own, before I started thinking about my own, right?
Erin, you have been... involved in as a clergy pastor. What, how did you think about death and where did death come into that part of your life? And as you work with people, how do you see us as a culture dealing with death?
Yeah. Well, it was the one aspect of my job that I was terrified of, you know, it was, because even when I graduated and was ordained, I'd really only been to a small handful of funerals in my whole life. You know, it was crazy. But I remember the first profound wake-up call I had, I was on my internship preparing to graduate, and I did my internship as a youth pastor in a large church, and my supervisor called me the night before and said, "Tomorrow, wear a suit." I said, "Why? Why am I wearing a suit? I'm a youth pastor. Why am I wearing a suit tomorrow?" He said, "Because we have a funeral." And I thought, well, how did I not know who died in the church? You know, I was kind of shocked. I said, "Who's the funeral for?" He said, "I don't know. We'll find out tomorrow." And I thought this was really strange. So the next day, I put on a suit and I came to church to work, to my internship. And I walked in my supervisor's office and I said, "So whose funeral are we going to?" He said, "I don't know. Go to the corner and buy a paper." So I went to the corner, bought the local paper, came back into the office, said, "Open up the obituaries, and you tell me which funeral we're going to today." And I thought, this is the strangest thing I've ever experienced. I said, "Why are we going to a funeral for people we don't know?" And he said, "Because we want to be reminded of what people are experiencing. It keeps us honest, it keeps us relevant, and yeah, it's part of your learning." It was one of the wisest experiences I'd ever had. I don't know if my supervisor had any clue how profound it was. And we happened to pick a funeral that day, that afternoon, that was at a small funeral home across from a high school. And it was a funeral for a high school student that was killed in a drunk driving accident. And the funeral home was directly across the road from the high school. And the police at the time, as a deterrent, put the wrecked car on the lawn of the school. And so this little chapel was jam-packed. And the students that came were emotional before the funeral because across the road is the car he died in. And here they are in this funeral home packed full of teenagers. And me and my supervisor sat at the back of this and we just bore witness. And I walked out of there and it changed me. It changed me. You know, it's one thing to go to funerals for people you know, because you can easily get distracted by relationships with people and conversations. You can talk about everything else but that box at the front of the room. But when you're at a funeral and you don't know anybody, and you're there to observe, you're there just to bear witness to someone else's grief, someone else's death, that really changed me. It was a very profound moment for me, and it kind of woke me up that this could be part of my role as a pastor. And what a sacred thing for me to do. So that was probably the earliest important moment. And then, of course, as a youth pastor, I didn't have a lot of funerals. It wasn't until I became a senior pastor and began to do funerals. And I realized that, for the most part, pastors are told how to do funerals. No one ever thinks. So we've been doing funerals the same way for 40 years. And we don't realize we don't have to do it this way. We have permission to grieve and share death in a unique way. It's not, you know, and I felt that first freedom to do that when my mom died. I'm the youngest of five kids. And like Amy said, my mom died in 12 weeks. And when we were planning the funeral, I said to my dad, "I have an idea, Dad. Let's do this different." He said, "Well, how do you want to do it?" I said, "Let's not let any minister speak. Because none of Mom's family knows this guy. And it's not an opportunity for someone to... I said, "Mom's life spoke of her faith. So let's let Mom speak." And he's like, "How are we going to let Mom speak?" And I said, "Let's let the five kids get up and tell a story. And you can share. And let's let that be the message." And instead of, the usual... because our family loves to eat, we love to celebrate. Family meals were huge. So after the funeral was over, it was a celebration. There were balloons, there were bowls of shrimp. We had catered in, you know, hundreds of spring rolls and all my mom's favorite foods. And people were perplexed at this funeral because it's like, this doesn't seem normal. But I felt the permission to actually change the way we celebrated mom's life, you know? And ever since then, now that I do funerals, I've done quite a few now that I've been a senior pastor, I don't begin with, "This is how we have to do it." I begin with, "How do we want to celebrate this? How do we want to sit with this? And where do we want to go with it?" And you have permission to do anything that's fitting. And yeah, so it's been quite a trajectory over the years. And I wouldn't say I'm comfortable, but I know how important they are and they're very sacred. So, yeah, it's an important part of what I do.
So how would you describe, Amy, the how this disease and the trajectory of this disease has changed your life in terms of the way you think and how you approach life and death?
That's a great question. I think that especially in the last 5 years, since I've been in this chair, since it took that big turn, I really feel like I am a very different person. And a lot of things in my life have changed in the physical sense. I grew up a good 3 hours away, drive from here. And so it would take 6 hours in a day. I have not been able to make that trip home since. So that has profoundly changed me. That's where all my family lives. That's where I grew up. It's something to be held back from something like that while you're still alive, because it's really not that far. So that definitely has had a profound impact on me and the way that I kind of, I don't know. Also, I haven't been at church in 5 years, which is another thing that was a weekly occurrence in my life. So that really changed too. So I had to evolve in ways that I hadn't thought of before, you know, and I had to somehow find my footing in amongst, no pun intended, like who am I now? Like, and who is, like, what parts of me are left that feel right and what parts needed to change? And I tried to, like, I fought it for a while and then I started to really embrace sort of this new version of myself in a way, you know? Yeah. It's like, it is literally like sometimes a butterfly, you know what I mean? Like in a cocoon, like that's, and so, I really like the version of myself now, which sounds funny, better than I ever have. Even though, you know, it comes with a lot of pain. And so I think that's, and that's kind of hard for people to understand sometimes too. Now, of course, I love this question because I get it all the time. Would you ever, like, if you could go back, you know, of course, if I could go back, I wouldn't want a disease, like, you know what I mean? Like that's just to me, you know. But the point I'm at now, I'm really happy with, and I love that I'm at the point where fear doesn't grip me the way it did before.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah.
Are you afraid of death?
No.
Are you afraid of dying?
Yes. No. I'm afraid, like I said, of the pain of what the process will be. And of course, leaving my loved ones. And I really, you know, I write a lot when I'm sick. And so I've written a lot about that too. And just about, you know, I will say to myself, you can't make their journey any easier for them, Amy. They have to do their work like you have to do yours. So you do your work and that will help them in some way, but ultimately, right, you know, I can't take the pain away from my children, you know, because, and I see them go through pain when I go through pain. And that's a hard thing as a parent and as the one who is the one doing the dying at the point, you know, we're on that path. So.
Yeah. So, Aaron, have you thought about your own dying?
Yeah, I have, as a natural consequence of my experiences with my wife and the experiences of my job. It probably in a more objective way, you know. I've been trying to do the inner work in the sense of having those conversations with myself. The more you're in touch with your mortality, I think the more effective you can be. And the less fear you have about anything, you know. And I also think that the more you get in touch with that as someone who's like me, who's a clergy, it changes the way you view God and it changes your theology completely, because our theology is, you know, so much of it is a carryover from the Middle Ages when, you know, death was a deterrent. And it was good for business. And we live in a day and age now where our theology, we still pull out these tactics of trying to scare people into faith. And it's like, none of those tactics matter or work. If you go right back to first century and look at the message of Jesus, you know, it wasn't, there wasn't this prosperity gospel at all that we have today. Instead, it was allowing us to be here now. And if we can learn to be here now, instead of this theology about escape, about leaving, if instead we recognize that the gospel is about learning to be here and knowing that Jesus offers us an alternative way to experience despair, an alternative way to experience hate and anger and greed, and that when we choose the alternative, the kingdom of God shows up. And when you realize that, man, that just changes everything. And one of the best impetus for that change in my thinking was to think about my own mortality. And that, what if this is it? Can faith be its own reward? Or do I need a carrot dangled at the end, offering me eternal life? I don't know, actually. I think that the way of Jesus is its own reward here and now. And I don't use heaven as a carrot to woo people into faith. Instead, I talk to them that faith works now, and if it doesn't work now, I'm not going to mortgage my present for the future. When, you know, I really think that God comes and helps us deal with all the deaths in this life. And that's to me the power too of Christian resurrection, the story of life where it shouldn't be. You know, I have thought about my own death, and it shows up in my preaching, it shows up in my relationships. I'll think about it more as it affects me.
So I'll ask both of you this, and it's kind of a, may seem strange, but so what does death mean to you?
Death to me is, it's a line. It's a line, it's a mysterious line that we're all walking towards. We're not walking away from, we're walking towards it. And at some point, we walk past this line. And what happens? We have ideas, we have hopes. But I'm more interested in what happens on this side of the line as I approach the line, because that's the stuff that I can control. That's the stuff that I can influence. That's the stuff that I can be present for. What happens on the other side of that line? I don't know for sure. I have ideas and hopes. There's a story that I attach myself to because it's a good story. But death to me is this, this mysterious line that I don't even know how thick the line is. I just know that it's a direction that we're all walking towards. And for some, we don't even know we're crossing that line. Amy's mom died instantly. She didn't know she was as close to that line as she was. My mom was dying for 12 weeks. So she got really close and then slowed down. And it was terrifying for her. But as I think about it, yeah, death to me is a beautiful colored line. Not this dark, foreboding line of barbed wire. No, it's this beautiful transition that is mysterious and beautiful, mm-hmm. and we're all walking towards it, some closer than others.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think when I think about death, I think death gives meaning to life. I think that's it. I think that that's the whole thing about death. I think it gives profound meaning to our lives. And I agree with Aaron. I think it's really mysterious, the death itself. Sometimes I actually get excited about it, which is really strange. I think anybody who's chronically ill understands that, and not in a foreboding way or like wanting to bring it on. But just that there is a little bit of anticipation because of the just not understanding like what that transaction will be like. You know, like anybody on this side can presume and say things about it, but really, you know, it's such a mystery. And I think that's just such a great point to get to when you're in the position that I'm in, to actually, because I have felt like I've peered over the edge a couple times. I always say that to people, you know, I've looked over the edge a few times, and it's like, you know. So when you've done that, you know, it kind of takes away the fear of that crossing. And who knows? What I do really believe is out there is love. I think that's what holds the whole universe together, and whatever that means and however that translates for whoever's in that crossing over time, I think it's going to mean different things for different people. But yeah, I really do believe death gives meaning to life. That is the point.
Thank you. If you'd have thought about death earlier in your life, your own life, and known it was, had that experience of understanding its reality, would it have made you decide things differently?
I think the obvious answer is it would, because I'm not the person I was. But I think if I was to think of what, if there was something significant that has influenced why that's changed, I think it's just my concept of time has changed. I've met a lot of people who have lost loved ones, especially children, and they're different after. And when I push them on it, they're good friends and I can, one of the things I've discovered is their just view of time is different now. Mm-hmm. Everything is much more
precious,
sacred. And one of the things that's really helped me is this notion that Eastern versus Western philosophy, in the West here, we have this concept that time's rushing towards us and we're going to miss all that we can't grab. And that's why we have no margin. That's why we're always exhausted, because we're just trying to get everything. And as such, we're always missing stuff. And even though our hands are full, we're looking at what's whizzing by us because we just can't keep up with this concept of time we have. But when you analyze it, time doesn't exist as we think about it. And I think the East has such a way better concept of time. The Eastern perception, at least one of the Eastern perceptions that I love, is this notion that time isn't rushing towards you, that we actually pull the future towards us with every choice we make, that we are standing in the present moment and nothing is happening until we choose. And even by doing nothing, we're making a choice. So life happens, but everything is a choice. Everything's a choice. So thinking about death in the sense that, well, I'm going to miss all this stuff that's rushing towards me. Well, nothing's rushing towards you. You're actually pulling everything towards you with the choices you make. So if you choose happiness, it's an option. If you choose meaning, it's an option. If you just choose despair, it's an option too, but it isn't life throwing it at you. It's a choice you're making and how you're responding to the situation you're in. It's still your choice. And even though the difference is, I don't think it's subtle, but some people it is. But for me, that's what I have to keep doing, is I just have to keep centering myself and becoming present. Otherwise, how do you live with someone as a chronic caregiver who has an expiration date? We all do, but theirs might be sooner. How do you think about the future? Mm-hmm. How do you plan for anything without having survivor's guilt? So what you do instead is you have to, I've made the choice to not think about time the same way. Mm-hmm. I think about all I have is this moment with her and my family, and that's enough. And what will we choose this day?
I sat with a friend of mine who was dying. She was only in her early 50s. Her husband had been with her all night and went home to get changed, but didn't want her being alone, and I volunteered to sit with her. This is what I wrote. To sit with dying, knowing that there is nothing one can do but to sit in the stillness of dying, with only the rhythm of labored breath, I wonder in these moments if something akin to telepathy is possible. Can this dying person know that I'm thinking of her? People talk about prayer as conversation with God, but can silent prayer be heard by the one that we are praying for? It seems so necessary to be present with dying and not to give in to the immediate urge to go and do something somewhere elsewhere. To be active with those who can respond to your efforts. The dying can't respond, but that doesn't mean they're not aware. What does a dying person need from me? Peace, not anxiety. Love and embrace, not anger or resentment. Grace, not bitterness. Stillness, not activity. Reconciliation, not revenge. Mystery, not answers. I have what is needed, but allowing this to be present means fighting through my outer self that wants to do and wants to get even, that wants to remember and hurts and wrongs and wants to speak of things thinking that I have answers. Can I sit in quietness? Can I be filled with love and kindness and gentleness and grace? Can I resist speech and explanation? Can I embrace and not pull back? Dying is what I need to learn. What I need to learn in order to face these things in others. Dying allows me to live, truly live. In fact, we are told to die daily by most major religions in various ways. Dying is the common denominator that all life shares. How we do this is experienced in vastly different ways. I want to be present in dying for others, and to be present in dying for myself. I want dying to shape my living so that all of those things needed to be with the dying will be present in my life now. Stillness, mystery, grace, forgiveness, and love. As Amy said, dying helps us live better. Thank you very much.